to our annual Darwen Lecture. Before I introduce our guest speaker for this afternoon, I thought I'd tell you a little bit about the Darwen, just in case you are wondering. And before I go any further, it's Darwen with an E, not Darwen with an I. And the Darwen Lectures were established as a whole school event in 1993 as a tribute to the Davis family, which has been linked with Sidcot for over 100 years. Several generations of the family, including the first and second Lord and Lady Darwen, hence the name, attended the school. The lectures have been established as a contribution to the continuing debate on the future of education and on wider society, and in particular the role of schools such as ours. Each year we aim to invite someone prominent in public life, possibly with a Sidcot connection, to offer a personal view in this lecture. And I am delighted that we have somebody very special to do our Darwen Lecture this afternoon. So Professor Peter Openshaw is a British clinician and scientist specialising in lung immunology, particularly defence against viral infections. He trained in lung diseases and undertook a PhD in immunology before establishing a laboratory at St Mary's Hospital Medical School, which later became Imperial College London. He created the Academic Department of Respiratory Medicine and the Centre of Respiratory Infection at Imperial College, and was elected President of the British Society for Immunology in 2014. So Professor Openshaw has a very distinguished academic career. However, you may be familiar with him from some of the things that he has done most recently. He has been a leading voice during the COVID-19 pandemic, advising government policy making and appearing regularly on the BBC, including the Andrew Marr Show, Question Time and the Today programme. His visionary approach has delivered life-changing research programmes, and his strong leadership has inspired researchers in their endeavours as well as provided reassurance to the public. He co-leads a UK-wide consortium established in 2020 to study the COVID-19 pandemic, and is a member of the Academy of Medical Sciences British Society for Immunology Expert Task Force on Immunology of COVID-19. Let's show our appreciation and welcome to Professor Peter Openshaw. Thank you.
It's a real privilege and a pleasure to be here. I think I'd like to start by saying just what a wonderful time I had at Sidcot, even though I was only here for 3 years. But I think it's been really formative in the way in which I've approached life, approached my career, and approached building research labs. I think the ethos which has been sort of instilled in me by Sidcot has been a tremendous asset through my life. And I hope at the end of this, I will give a few more personal reflections. But I thought, by way of introduction, I'd like to say to begin with, that I come from a Quaker background. So I was born into a Quaker family in Glastonbury, not very far from here. So I grew up in Glastonbury. My grandmother was a Morland. A lot of my cousins were clerks, so the Clarks and Newlands clan were very much my family. I had a very sort of free upbringing, I think. Even before I came to Sidcot, a lot of time was spent playing in fields and barns, and fortunately was able to develop that while I was here. I was not a great pupil, I must say. I was diagnosed with dyslexia at the age of about 7, which was quite unusual in those days to actually be diagnosed with dyslexia. And I guess that, looking back, I probably had a degree of ADHD as well. So, actually being a bit ADHD is not a bad thing if you're a professor. You need to jump from one thing to another and focus very keenly on those different things. I've always loved storytelling. I think that partly came from not being a great reader, but loving being told stories by family members, for example. And I love the outdoors, and I think being at Sidcot really helped me to develop an interest in the outdoors. I wasn't a very healthy child. I had a lot of trouble with my chest. I was a chesty, wheezy child. That maybe is one of the reasons that I've ended up as a chess physician and specialising in trying to understand childhood origins. origins of asthma. Just in terms of not being a very good pupil, I actually developed a sulfur burning machine so that I could go down into my experiment shed and generate sulfur fumes, which would cause wheezing, and I'd then go up to present to my mother as a GP. She'd see how wheezy I was and would put me to bed and write a note to the school saying I couldn't do games. So I wasn't an ideal pupil by any means. You can see here, this is me. I was obsessed by Sherlock Holmes. This was me dressed as I envisioned Sherlock Holmes before I came to Sidcot. And then you can see the effect that Sidcot had on me. This is me after I left school with my Vauxhall Viva. You can see I picked up a smoking habit, much to the annoyance of the teachers here. So that wasn't very good for my chest either. So in terms of what I currently do, so I trained in medicine, went into chess medicine, partly because chess physicians I thought were nice people. So a lot of, there are various branches of medicine and surgery where there's a lot of pretty aggressive people, very high achieving, competitive, but in chess medicine, that's not the case. So I think that's one of the reasons I chose chess medicine. Nerve tag. So you may have heard of nerve tag. This is the new and emerging respiratory threats advisory group, which is a government advisory group. And I was chair for a while, and I've been vice chair during the current pandemic, and various other roles, mainly to do with running research teams. Now this one at the bottom, mentioned, this is for 5 years I was elected by the staff at Imperial to be what we call the consul. So a consul is somebody who looks after the ethos of the college, who chairs disciplinary hearings. So you're part councillor, part magistrate, I guess. And now they've created this new role called proconsul, because I've done my 5 years and could no longer be a consul, but they've created this new role, so I'm now a proconsul, where I basically do the same sort of stuff, but I'm no longer remunerated centrally by the college, but anyway, it's technically so. But I've been put in charge of the committee now to try and reform the ethos of Imperial College. We had some recent issues where some very senior members of management were found guilty of bullying. And in response to that, Imperial has set up various commissions and boards. And I chair this board called Imperial Together Action Group, which is to try and instill better moral principles into the way in which we work. So, and again, I think that interest in that aspect of things comes back to my time at Sidcot. So, let's talk a bit about diseases. Because diseases are what has been really fascinated me throughout my career. And this is a graph from the National Risk Register. It comes out of the Cabinet Office. And here we've got the impact of different events. And along the bottom, we've got the relative likelihood of those events. So, high in likelihood, high in impact, we've got pandemic human diseases. So this goes back some time. The civil service does these exercises every year where it looks at the relative impact and the relative likelihood of different events, and it moves these blobs around. So it's always been very high in government priorities. And in terms of emerging diseases, I've now been fairly central to two pandemics in the last 10 years, 12 years. Both the swine flu pandemic and now COVID-19. I've been very much involved in government policy. And if you think about where these diseases come from, so there's often a natural host, so this could be bats, or it could be pigs, or it could be ducks, a natural host. Relatively stable virus in that other host, and then
for various reasons to do with things like pressure on the environment or global travel or increased urbanisation. You know, there's pressure on these natural hosts that lead to species jump into a secondary host, which could be humans. And at that time, the virus has to begin to find its way in evolutionary terms, and so it will tend to evolve relatively rapidly in the new host in order to exploit the characteristics of the new ecological niche that it's discovered. So if you think about the monkeypox, which has recently been found in a number of different countries around the world, you know, there's going to be evolutionary pressure now on monkeypox to adapt to its new way of life and to find ways of improving its genetic behavior so that it can exploit a new evolutionary niche and then build on that. So that's the sort of general principle. So here's an influenza virus, so a really classic RNA virus. Generally, you know, behaves in a fairly uninteresting way ecologically, in that it gets in, it replicates, and it gets out as fast as it can. And then evolves to develop new variants which are sufficiently unlike the previous variant so that the mainly antibody mediated defenses can be evaded. And so you have these antigenic shifts and drifts, and recombination. So it's got 8 genes which it can shuffle like a pack of cards and come out with a different deck, which gives it an advantage in terms of transmissibility. So there's reassortment, there's mutation, and it's a very nimble sort of virus. It generates thousands or millions of copies of itself, each of which is the throw of an evolutionary dice, and which allows the virus to try to exploit whatever transmission events are available to it. So if we think about the swine flu pandemic, so 2009-2010, I think there's somebody online who needs to mute. So in the swine flu pandemic, at that time, I think we had all 6 of our children at Allains in South London. So a lot of the kids went on Easter break and then came back from the States and brought swine flu to Allains in Dulwich. And the schools closed down, and we were all summoned into the school and were given packs of oseltamivir, Tamiflu, in order to try and ring fence the outbreak, which was at that time first declared really at Allains and elsewhere. So schools were very central to the transmission and amplified the transmission of swine flu. It was a triple reassortment virus, so there were bits of it which came from swine, other bits which were relatively human, and some bits were avian. So it managed to bring different components of previous viruses together in a way that created this very large wave of infections. At the time, it was very hard to know whether we were seeing a lot of hospitalizations because the severity was very high, but the case numbers was low because all the methods of detection that we were using were not adapted to detect this novel H1N1 virus. So the antibody tests on blood or the detection methods where we were looking for antigen weren't ideal for this virus. And that took about 6 months to develop.
Sorry,
Peter, the classroom, they can't see your PowerPoint, so
we just need to switch it over.
Just while we're waiting, does anyone want to ask any questions at this time? I'd be very happy for people to stick their hands up, interrupt me. It'd be nice to get a bit of dialogue going.
Can I ask a question about spots, finally? Because I do remember the school I was at then having to write an action plan for that, in the case that it became far more prevalent than it did.
Yeah.
And maybe you're going to go on and say why it didn't.
Right.
But that would be just interesting to know. It seemed like it was something we were all prepared for,
yeah,
and then didn't happen, in converse to COVID, where it was something we weren't really prepared for and certainly did happen.
Is that good? Is that all working out?
Check.
I mean, that's really the important question, because, you know, we were projecting that it was going to spread like wildfire, but we didn't know how far it had spread already. And actually, when the first blood tests became available to tell whether people had been infected or not because of antibody, once those were developed, which was towards the autumn in 2009, there was a school survey done, actually, where they bled a lot of the kids, and they showed that there was a lot of infection which had happened without causing any serious disease. And the modellers who were projecting how many deaths we were likely to see, how many numbers of serious cases we were likely to see, almost overnight, they keyed these numbers into their models and were able to say, it's not so bad. You know, instead of 200,000 deaths, which was still on the cards, you know, it was looking more like the sort of low thousands or high hundreds. So, you know, completely changed the picture. Is that all right?
It's all good.
Good. Okay. Right. So, so there were two waves of infection. There were two waves of infection during the pandemic. So the pandemic was then declared over once we realized that it wasn't quite so serious. But it wasn't so bad. It almost was like a live attenuated vaccine strain spreading through communities all around the globe. So in a way, it almost immunized people via this nasal route. It did cause a very large number of hospitalizations, but that was just very few people at the sort of tip of the iceberg. So a lot of mild disease. So I was. So I was asked by the Wellcome Trust to set up a national investigation into the causes of severe influenza. And this was called Mechanisms of Severe Influenza Consortium, Mosaic. And they invited me to put in a grant just after Easter. It took us 6 weeks to write this major grant with 45 co-investigators. We went out to the referees. The Wellcome Trust then used its most rapid processes to revise the budget. And then the lawyers sort of went on holiday in August, so the contracts were written. And then Imperial wouldn't let us actually start doing any work until they had the actual signed document from the Wellcome Trust. So essentially, this is not the way to do research. You can't wait until the normal processes have been done. So we set up some sleeping protocols, we refined our questionnaires, and we basically kept all this ticking over. We got more than 200 legal agreements with hospitals set up all around the country, so that if there was another pandemic, we would then be able to do things much more rapidly. Okay, so, and then that all paid off because of COVID-19. But just to introduce coronaviruses, these are huge viruses. They're the largest RNA viruses that we've got. There's coronaviruses that specialize in almost every mammalian species and many non-mammalian species, so they're extremely widespread. And they often have the ability to cross species barriers. So they're a really quite extraordinary set of viruses. And because they've got a very large genome, they can accommodate within that genome a lot of abilities to control the host immune response. So they're not the sort of quick in-out viruses that influenza can be. They can get in and take control of the machine, you know, like taking over a spaceship, invading the flight deck, you know, grabbing hold of the controls. This is what these sort of viruses do. They tend to have a relatively stable genome, but they can activate and deactivate genes much more easily with smaller viruses. So they're pretty interesting. And of course, back in 2002, there'd been this really quite terrifying SARS outbreak. I don't know if anyone here remembers that, but it was
very scary from our point of view, because the mortality at that time was around 10%. 10%. Now that is a huge mortality. You know, if that had spread as a respiratory pathogen around the world, it would have been absolutely devastating. And we didn't think that it was necessarily controllable, especially once it arrived in Toronto. You know, once it got out into Toronto, we thought maybe things were lost. But public health measures got on top of it, and it was defeated. And the last three cases of SARS Mark 1 were in laboratory workers who'd been working with coronavirus in not very good laboratory facilities, and they'd happened to get infected from their cultures. So I think that sort of puts it all in context. So then we've got the 2019-2020 outbreak. And I remember being at a conference in February in Galveston, Texas, actually, and just watching day by day the numbers coming down in China and thinking, oh, thank goodness, you know, it looks like SARS all over again. This one will be defeated. But then the news broke that it had got into northern Italy and into Iran. And I thought, we're lost. There's no way this is going to be controlled. And you can see what happened after that day, rapid explosive growth in other areas, in this case both in Europe and in the Americas, and then seeing that in even longer scale. You can see Europe originally drove spread, and then it spread to the Americas, and things were basically uncontrollable, but the Chinese almost did it. They almost locked it down. If only there had been a little bit more intensive effort, maybe a week earlier, that would have been enough. And it's extraordinary to think that all of that came from one virus particle with a strand of RNA. This whole thing is originating just from one virus particle that had a particular set of mutations that allowed it to then jump and spread. So I won't go into details about the sort of work we're doing, but this is a paper that we published, really looking at what the disease is caused by in terms of the type of immune response which runs out of control in people with this particular coronavirus infection. I don't think it's appropriate to go into all the immunological detail, but basically the immune system has two aspects to it. There's the good part, which defends against infection, and there's the bad part, which is the inflammatory response to infection. And characterizing the inflammatory response to infection allows you to identify drugs like the IL-6 blockers, tocilizumab, which some of you may have heard of being used to treat people with COVID-19, or steroids. You know, some of this information depends very much on steroids phase. So if we think about the early phase when the virus has just entered and is establishing infection, and then you get viral replication. So in this phase, very early on, almost before symptoms, that's the time to give antiviral drugs. So the best effect of antiviral drugs is within hours of symptoms onset, or as soon as you know you've got infection. If you wait 2-3 days, antivirals are not going to do anything much. The train left the station, it's off down the track, and at that point, attacking the virus is not meant to do anything very much. But later on, there's a lot of activation of the innate immune system, macrophages, tumor necrosis factor, IL-6, granulocyte macrophage, common stimulating factor, GM-CSF, which is a factor that we've identified as being involved. All of this then becomes something which you can do to treat the disease. So, I could give a long lecture on this, I think instead just talking a bit generally about what the risk factors for spread are. And I think this is an interesting graphic because it's a pretty carefully thought through spectrum of what's risky and what's relatively safe. So outdoor exercise, go up a coombe, go for a long walk, keep out in the fresh air, playing tennis, you know, all of that's really safe. And I think we could have had a much better time in lockdown. We'd appreciate it because there's a whole group of things down this end that really are not listening to it. Having parties in Downing Street, probably more up this end there, indoor parties. So that's not safe. And walking around in the light of death, not safe, particularly if it's underventilated and there's big crowds of people together. I'm afraid singing in church is a high risk activity. Okay, so this is, I think, a nice paper because it illustrates the way in which spread can be localized in a particular region of the room by an air conditioning unit. So here's an air conditioning unit. Back of a restaurant. This is where people come in. And you can see that there was a person who was infected with SARS-CoV-2 here. And the air conditioning unit basically whipped the air round and round in circles and infected this whole cluster of people at this end of the restaurant. People up here weren't infected at all. So I think this and many, many other studies really show the importance of airborne transmission. To my mind, it's undeniable. This is largely an airborne transmissible virus, and masks work. So I don't know when you want to stop wearing masks. I still carry a mask around and wear it if I'm in a situation where I think that it may be stuffy or I'm breathing other people's air. This is from the CDC in the USA. They've looked very carefully at what works, and they've advised that masks, particularly the highly effective masks, which are well fitted, really do reduce the risk of transmission very significantly indeed. It doesn't mean to say that other things don't stop transmission, but I think that anyone who doubts the importance of masks really needs to look at this sort of evidence. And there are many people who doubt the importance of masks, particularly on various political extreme poles. So, this is, I think, a nice way of thinking about the way in which you can layer on protection. Masks work, distancing works, fresh air works, and if you layer each of these on, like a layer on Swiss cheese, then you can actually prevent the virus from getting through. So this is the basis of public health, is you need not just one measure, you need multiple measures. So vaccines are great, but they alone are not going to be totally impermeable as a barrier to transmission. So, don't believe people if they say, we've got vaccines, we don't need to bother with any vaccine. You have to layer all these factors together to really build effects. But it wouldn't be right to not say a bit about vaccines. So vaccines certainly are an extraordinary success. I think that we in the sort of immunological community are hugely proud of the way in which vaccines worked. Many of us thought that there was no possibility that we'd have vaccines available within months. Maybe 3-4 years, we thought. I remember a few years ago when I was doing quite a lot of vaccine work, it was taking us 12 to 15 years from concept through to actual having a vaccine out there. And to be able to get vaccines out there by the end of 2020 was amazing. But not all vaccines are totally equal. And this is a sort of ranking of the different vaccines according to how powerful they are in generating antibody, which roughly probably equates to how powerful they are in terms of reducing transmission. So the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine, which I guess, would most of you have had that? Or would you have had the AstraZeneca-Oxford vaccine?
AstraZeneca.
How many of you have actually had vaccines? Interesting. No. Okay, so lots of people have had vaccines. So can you put your hands up to the AstraZeneca? Okay, and Pfizer-BioNTech? Interesting. Good. Right. So, but if you have a mixture of vaccines, that's quite good too. The so-called mix and match approach, so you get one vaccine and then boost it with another, makes immunological sense, actually. Have different vaccines that together create very strong immunity. So there is a sort of ranking of vaccines. Sinovac. Now, that is being rolled out quite widely in China, but there's been a lot of vaccine resistance in China, particularly amongst the under 60s. You wouldn't have thought that that would be a problem, but it really is. And you know, I'm so glad that we're not in the position that China is now in, where they're having to lock down large scale, very poor vaccine coverage, very ineffective vaccines which they've been using in their population. And I certainly wouldn't like to be in the situation that they are in North Korea, where they haven't been vaccinated. They've got a very large outbreak, a highly transmissible variant, and the Omicron is transmissible. It's really gone through many hoops to gain transmissibility. And they've got very poor health services, in a hospital with no running water. And I think it's terrifying what's going on in those parts of the world. Yes? Speak up a bit, yeah. Right. So there are different side effect profiles, and in particular, there's been concern about the use of vaccines in teenagers and younger children because of rare events of inducing various inflammatory disorders. I mean, if you look at the frequency of adverse effects of catching COVID, those are 10 to 100 times more common. So these are not very common adverse effects. But that does, to some extent, determine which vaccines should be used in which age groups and whether boosters are necessary. Because mainly in boys with second dose that there were adverse effects. There was a problem with using the AstraZeneca vaccine in older adults, because the way in which they developed that vaccine was they tested it initially in younger adults. By the time you moved into the older adult age group, there weren't many cases of COVID around in places where they were doing that testing, so there was a lack of data. And that led to President Macron saying that this is a partially ineffective vaccine, and that was a great harm to that vaccine. Yes.
Just on the subject of vaccines, and hindsight's always a wonderful thing, you know, to kind of look back on how we did things. But the government very much focused, when the vaccine became available, on the older members of the population and those most vulnerable, and eventually got down to those in schools and got down to the age groups of these guys here.
Yeah.
As a result, we had two lockdowns. The first lockdown wasn't pleasant. I think the second lockdown was even worse.
Yeah.
Was that the right way to do it, to focus on the sort of more older, elderly and vulnerable, and then the younger, or should there have been a slightly different approach?
So my colleagues and friends who are on the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation have been given a very strict brief of deciding which groups will personally benefit most from vaccines. And they've been told not to give consideration to the wider implications of vaccination in terms of controlling the outbreak for societal benefit. So they were, within that brief, they were absolutely right to work down through the age groups and risk groups in those 10 different categories that they identified, which didn't include children. And the earliest variants, the original Wuhan, some of those early variants, were not really transmitting very much among school children, according to the epidemiologists. So that really steered the advice away from vaccinating school children, whereas swine flu was definitely being amplified and enhanced by breeding in schools, but the original strains didn't really. With the more highly adaptive variants, and particularly the Omicron, that was really moving down the age groups and beginning to infect children much more. And so the argument for vaccinating children then really shifted into vaccinating children, partly for their benefit, but also for the societal benefit of reducing transmission in schools. I went out in public very much in favour of vaccinating children. Some others, there's a prominent immunologist in Bristol actually, Adam Finn, who was on JCVI, he really went public saying, you know, we mustn't vaccinate children for the benefit of others, we must protect children at all costs. So he and I were rather up against each other in the media. And I got quite a few death threats, anti-vax people threatening to injure me and my children, some very nasty stuff, public demonstrations during the lectures. Yeah, so, and at one stage we actually had sort of surveillance people who were watching our backs, making sure they were not attacked. And there was a demonstration outside my office with people with loud hailers calling for me to come out and face the music over my recommendation that children should be vaccinated. So it's a very contentious area, but to my mind, the evidence has swung in favour of vaccinating children.
It's a difficult one.
Yeah. Just put this up, you know, because they're not all equal in terms of how much antibody they generate. They're also not equal in terms of cost. Now, this is Moderna, developed by the US, with lots of government support, actually. And this is one of the most expensive vaccines. Whereas if you look at the Oxford-AstraZeneca, the absolute policy of the group developing that vaccine was this was going to be a vaccine for the world, which could be delivered at volume and at pace to people in low and middle income countries. This wasn't just a vaccine for the privileged rich. And I think some of the adverse news reports and so on is actually being rather driven by the. There's been quite a lot of media feed against the Oxford-AstraZeneca. Partly because it's undercutting the others who are actually making big profits out of these vaccines. So, you know, do vaccines work? People still argue that, you know, vaccines don't work, particularly if you're strong and healthy. Well, the fact is that if we look at who gets admitted to intensive care, so this is a big national study from ICNARC, you know, essentially the intensive care departments became the departments for the unvaccinated. If you've been vaccinated, even with one dose, you're very, very unlikely to end up in intensive care. If we then look at, these are data from the US, so this is just focusing on Los Angeles, where we have relatively uniform data. And you can see the effect of household income. So these are wealthy households, these are relatively not wealthy. And you can see the not wealthy households are clustered down here with high rates of COVID, the wealthy households low rates of COVID, and it's related to the proportion who get vaccinated. So there's big polarization, particularly in the US, between those with money get vaccinated, those who are poor and with little information don't get vaccinated. If we look at public spending, I think this is a particularly interesting chart, you know, how much money went into these vaccines, which are absolutely life-saving, compared to how much money went into other ones. So if you look at the cost of vaccines down here, it's minuscule compared to what it's cost us as a nation to respond. And yet, the politicians are not uniformly in favour of listening to scientific advice or to people calling for greater vaccine rollout. It's become politically polarised, even in this country. And certainly mask wearing has become politically polarised. You know, people put aside masks on the basis of their politics, which is, to me, an extraordinary thing. And I think Matt Hancock, actually, was a very good minister. Very responsive. You know, sometimes we'd be debating something in NervTech in the morning, and an hour or two later we'd hear that being quoted directly in the House of Commons. So we know that Matt Hancock was very responsive. But he was replaced by somebody whose main interest is economics. So I think, you know, the what's become evident is that there's a real sort of information war going on, as well as trying to tackle the outbreak. And if you look at the horseman of the apocalypse, the misinformation. Okay, I hope, am I going too slow? Is this all right? So let's now just think about fox viruses. Sorry to keep squeamish about fox viruses. These are very much in the news at the moment. This is actually a PhD student of mine who was working on fox virus a few years ago. He just had his eyebrow pierced, he got an infection in his finger, and he was fiddling with his eyebrow piercing, and managed to get this vaccinial ophthalmitis. This is another person who used to work on that, who got vaccinated with the vaccinia virus, much more virulent than the current vaccine against smallpox, which is being used for monkeypox. And she got quite a nasty inflamed lesion. But this virus was used to prevent smallpox. Sometimes people with eczema, if they've got a lot of eczema on their arms or legs, if you vaccinate them, then those eczematous lesions can get super infected with vaccinia. But it does work very well against monkeypox. So, you know, pox viruses are a great story to tell about the way in which smallpox was eliminated by vaccination with vaccinia virus. And this is Edward Jenner. Does anyone know what Edward Jenner was famous for before he did this? Yes?
He essentially created the first vaccine.
So, actually, I mean, probably Mary Workling and others had developed vaccines before, and there were other stories of vaccination. But he was famous for discovering something else. He was admitted to the Royal Society for...
Was it cowpox and smallpox?
No. 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 No guesses. So he was the first person to describe how cuckoos made their eggs in other nests. So he was very famous, actually. He was a famous naturalist before he put his considerable energy and his networks into trying to defeat smallpox, which was a complete scourge. It was maiming and stealing and killing thousands of people. And the experiment that he did, infecting the child of one of the people in his household with vaccinia virus from a cow, and then trying to deliberately inoculate them with smallpox, was a famous one. But actually, doing that experiment wasn't his idea, it was John Hunter's idea. So John Hunter was a rather marvellous character. He grew up in the countryside with very little learning or schooling until he was in his late teens, and then decided to make something of himself, went to London, and was famous for his lecturing not in Latin but in vernacular. And he did this famous experiment where he tried to discover how venereal disease was transmitted and how it developed by doing an experiment of taking a larsen dipped in venereal lesion and then inoculating it onto a penis. It's not sure whose penis it was, but it could easily have been his own, and then giving public lectures which people would pay to come and hear the latest report of how his venereal disease was evolving. So it was he who actually wrote to Jenner and said, you know, okay, I think you're onto something here, but why not try the experiment? So it was he who said, you know, go and infect the boy, fix, and then try and give him smallpox. So there is a long British tradition of doing deliberate infection, and we've just published a study where we did deliberate infection of volunteers with SARS-CoV-2. This is the first clinical description. We're just working on other publications about this experimental infection. We've been doing experimental infections for about 15 years now in Bali. We've done experimental infection with other respiratory viruses, including including influenza and others. So, you know, there's a lot of ethics involved in trying to ensure that when you do these deliberate experimental injections, you're observing good ethical principles. And I wanted to just move to talking a bit about bringing ethics into science. So at Imperial College, we've had issues over ethics and over ethos, which very much comes to the fore in recent times. And we set up this working together task group. Ian Morrison, as Bob asked me to co-chair this group, trying to look at the way in which we behave in science at Imperial and trying to instill these principles of respect and integrity alongside innovation, collaboration, and excellence as our core values. And we've been really developing these principles. And I've been quietly referring back to Baker principles, actually, in trying to shape what we're doing. And so I've here just put a couple of quotes from the advice and queries. You know, are you honest and truthful in all that you say and do? Do you maintain strict integrity in your dealings with others? So, you know, I think that if you look to the advices and the queries, and these are a few quotes from the advices and queries, these are really good guides for how to do science. So, beginning in 15 years is really building communities of scientists based on these principles, which I really think are principles of Quakerism. So, I'm not telling people that I'm acting as a Quaker here, but I'm sometimes referred to in board meetings as the Quaker for this reason. This is, I think, a lovely quote from George Fox. So, be patterns, be examples, then you will come to walk cheerfully over the world, answering that of God in everyone. So, I'm not a godly Quaker. I would say that although I do very much believe in Quaker principles, I'm not a great believer in the supernatural. I'm really a scientist. But I think the same would apply to my grandmother. So, this is Molly Scott Stokes, who was Molly Morland when she was here at Sidcot between 1911 and 1916. So this was really the time of the First World War. So she was a very sporty girl. And actually, while the war was still going on, so 1916, she went to France to help with Quaker relief. In France, because the society had been decimated by the war and was continuing to be decimated. She then got into something very unusual for a girl to go to Oxford in those days and became a hockey blue, and then went on to the Sidcot Committee and was temporarily headmistress in 1937. I don't know why that was, why she became headmistress, and was president of Old Scholars. You know, she was one of the best friends sitting there. I'm not sure where that quote came from, but that quote was in one of her one of the biographies that we're looking at. And I know we've just got a special event going on this week, haven't we? And I was wondering if the headmaster would sanction a torchlight procession up Wavering in the dark with all the school holding torches. That is something you need to be able to do.
I'll go away and think about that.
So there's lovely letters that she wrote from Sidcot, and this is a letter back from her father, written from the National Liberal Club. So you can imagine the breathless letter. I'm gazing for the rest of the term, but it was not for anything much. It was Miss Ledbetter, not Miss Wilson. And Miss Wilson says that if I'm invited out, I may go. I'll tell you the particulars on Thursday. So she's very excited about being gated. And I'm afraid I did rather continue her naughty style when I was at school. It was not a very well-behaved pupil. it's interesting that the letter back from her father, John Colby Morland, is written in the Quaker style with thou wilt, not mind me having an extra letter this week. Yes, busy firing wise. A very active tongue my little daughter has, no doubt, it will be very useful later on, but meanwhile seems to secure me a great deal of out of school employment. So here's a picture of my grandmother when she was in France doing Quaker women's work. See these poor kids she's looking after. And that brings me on to my mother, who was also a Sincotian. So she was at school around the time of the Second World War. She too went to Somerville, became a GP in Glastonbury, and then was mayor on two occasions, and was also a Sitka governor. And I remember when I was at school here, being greatly embarrassed by her speaking to the assembled children and saying all sorts of indiscreet things, which I thought were unwise at the time. And this is a couplet written about her when she was a little toddler, which I think reminds me of her very much. So, what did I gain from Sitka? Well, I think it instilled a lot of sort of Quaker principles into me. I really grew to love the hills and the woods, and I do hope that you too take advantage of any freedom that you might still be allowed in getting out into the hills and the woods and going for lovely walks. I think that although I clashed well with some of the teachers while I was here, particularly Aubrey Holmes, who was the chemistry teacher, he did actually teach me an experimental approach. He taught me, you know, how to design the experiment, how to judge the outcome of the experiment. And you know, I think that the way in which I've designed my experimental work has come from that teaching. And I think, you know, Quakers are free thinkers, so we trust our senses, we don't believe dogma. And I think the friendships that I developed while I was at Sitka have been very much in that form. And I think trying to instill kindness into science is an absolute principle which I hope to spend my next few years on. So thank you all very much, and thank you for being Sincotians.
Clearly through the journey, particularly around COVID, about immunology and all the work that you're doing. We have somebody who's not only just an academic, but somebody who's a real leader in his field, so it's a great opportunity. If you have any questions, Peter's very kindly agreed to take them. So any questions from the floor that you'd like to ask? Yes.
What was your favourite subject at school?
I think chemistry, actually, was my best subject. And I think it irritated Mr. Hopes that I always came top of the class, even though he thought I was one of the naughtiest boys in the school. So I really liked science. French. I quite enjoyed French. I actually quite liked a lot of things. I wasn't very gamesy. I tended to resist team sports.
That's a great question. Thank you. The back, yes.
I have a couple of questions. How do you predict the COVID is going to move on forward from now? Is the pandemic over? Because in England we're not wearing masks.
My second
question is, do you think the government should have kept mask wearing in public spaces for longer than they did?
Personally, yes. I thought it was premature to declare the COVID was over. And I think we would have had considerably fewer deaths and hospitalizations if we kept going for at least 2 weeks, perhaps another four. So I was against that opening up. But I completely understand that there were very strong political pressures towards getting on with life. And you know, as I said, I'm very glad we're not in the position that they are now in China or North Korea. So, yeah. I think we should have been a bit more cautious, but then I come from the health side of the argument.
What about the future? When is it going to end?
Future, I think we're all just waiting to see what happens with variants. So there's some very interesting sub-variants developed in South Africa and North America, which look like they could be even more transmissible. Whether we're going to arrive at a situation where we're going to have a very transmissible agent which is not very likely to cause disease, and which could in a way spread around the globe and immunize people via their nasal mucosa, that would almost be ideal. So that has been observed with coronaviruses in pigs, where there was a very nasty gastrointestinal version of coronavirus, mutated into being a common cold coronavirus in pigs, swept throughout Europe and annihilated its original virus. So then, so it's something you've just got a big grant to work on, or some diarrhea virus. Then lost her field of work and became retrained in my lab for 3 years to work on respiratory viruses.
Thank you.
Okay.
What would you tell a person who's an anti-vax and whose argument is that there's not enough research of the effects of the vaccine in the long term?
Well, I think there's not enough known yet about the long-term effects of COVID. You know, if I was offered the choice of a vaccine which is representative of the surface protein of the virus, or being exposed to the whole virus with all its complexity and ability to manipulate those and the potential for long COVID, you know, the evidence at the moment is absolutely in favour of vaccination, not in favour of catching COVID. And I think that is the choice. And catching COVID on the background of having been vaccinated is better than catching COVID having not been vaccinated. So, you know, I've gone carefully through the literature, and I'm absolutely sure that these vaccines are, you know, not 100% safe, nothing is 100% safe, but are extraordinarily good at protecting against COVID, and also giving you a more certain future than catching COVID. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
Right in the back corner, yeah. And then we'll go down to this side.
When COVID first started, did you think that it would last this long?
Well, when it first started, I thought the Chinese were going to nail it, actually. I thought that they would probably manage to eliminate it because they were making such extraordinary efforts. But once it got out, I think none of us could then predict what was going to happen. A lot of us were feeling optimistic, and then the optimism was dashed by the emergence of the new variant. Been this almost 6 or 7 month cycle of, you know, case numbers dropping, new variant comes out, case numbers drop, new variant comes out. How long that oscillation is going to go on is a bit unpredictable, but I think it might go on for maybe a few years yet. Actually, we're going to still have a lot of cases. You know, at the moment in this country, I don't know if people know how many people a week are dying of COVID.
Between 200 and 500 maybe?
Yeah, depends how you count, but I think the most reliable way of counting probably leads to about 700 to 800 a week dying. Now, if we were starting from where we were, say, in the middle of 2019, and suddenly we had that number of deaths happening every week, it would be a disaster. But because, you know, politically, we've been through the worst. You know, this is now acceptable.
How did you
choose
what university
to go to? I couldn't get into most of them. So I didn't get a great A-level result, despite being sent to the College North, away from all the lovely girls and sociability at Sydney. Being deprived of the things that I enjoyed in order to try and get some better grades. I didn't get great grades, and I almost didn't get into any medical school. It was actually, I went to Millfield to try and cram to retake in order to have another go. And then, surprise, surprise, I managed to get in to Guy's, where I think they just interviewed me as a sort of wild card, because I put on my application form that I enjoyed not tying, And there was one of the people on the interview panel who was a lot tired. And we thought, right, let's see if he can touch him off. So I went into the interview and he threw me a handle rope and said, tie me a knot. So I tied him a knot, and then he tied up a knot, and all the way through the interview, he tied knots. And I think that relaxed me, and I sort of opened up, and came off a new place. And actually, I really loved being here. It was the first time I really discovered learning, actually, and I thrived at medical school, and you know, got prizes, and finally understood what it was to be an academic. But I wasn't very academic when I was a student, often doing very well in chemistry.
That's reassuring words for those of you out there. But the moral of the story is, if you're going to put something in UCAS versus a statement you can do, be prepared today.
Have you had COVID, and with the rapid rollout of the vaccine, was all the efforts of like mass vaccination, were they filled, like informed consent, ability to like allow your information, were they all filled?
Yes. So I haven't had it. I caught it in March, as many of us did. Despite being fully vaccinated. So I had 3 doses of vaccine that I caught COVID. I was quite sick, but not for very long. And then about 4 weeks later, I started feeling grotty again, and I had another clicker on my rapid flow test. So it's a bizarre virus. I think I was almost glad, as a mucosal immunologist, finally have a mucosal challenge, bringing my immune system into where it matters, because just stimulating your immune system generally via the intramuscular route doesn't really give the immune system the clue that where it needs to focus is the moist lining of the nose and lung. So in a way, you know, catching COVID, having been vaccinated, that gives you a clear position. In terms of the speed of development and the ethics, so ethics was speeded up, and there was a lot of debate with ethics committees about how we could accelerate various processes. But I don't think that ethics was suspended in any way. Part of the reason the vaccines were developed so fast was that there were a vast number of cases, and it's easy to do experimental studies when you've got a lot of material to work with. If you're having to wait for sporadic seasonal infections, it's going to take years. And you need Europe-wide studies, maybe, to answer the question. Whereas when you've got hundreds of people pouring into every hospital, you can do these studies very fast. And a lot of the processes that you need to develop vaccines were done not sequentially, but sort of in parallel. So there were no shortcuts taken. All the right things were done, and all the right safety precautions were taken, but it was just done really fast.
Thanks for that. From Daisy and then Alex. So Daisy.
How do you think the past 2 years would have played out if the government would have put the country into lockdown, for example?
Right. So there have been people working on that, trying to model how many fewer deaths there might have been. So with the first lockdown, I remember thinking, why haven't we locked down? Because we had advised them that lockdown was necessary. The epidemiologists had said, this, we've reached the threshold, we need lockdown. And the days ticked by, and it was several weeks too late. If we'd gone 2 weeks earlier, the calculation was that 20,000 fewer people would have died. That's the sort of, it is possible to model these things and to work out what political decision making translates into in terms of deaths.
Thanks for that. Alex.
How do you think the SARS outbreak and the swine flu outbreak, if at all, have prepared the UK for an outbreak such as COVID-19? How do you think that the pandemic will prepare or provide research or knowledge to a potential other endemic or pandemic in the future?
I think they were the experience that we gained from 2002, 2003 SARS, and from 2009 to 2010 swine flu were absolutely essential in terms of being as prepared as we were. And what worries me is that despite all that massive preparation, all those sleeping protocols that we put into place, all that work that we did to try and be the best we could, we still didn't do very well in terms of the number of cases and number of deaths. And that is the thing that's really worries me. How can we do better next time? What can we learn in addition? And there's actually there's a number of task forces being set up. I'm on the one from the Academy of Medical Sciences, where we've been looking forward and looking back to see what it is that we could have done better. And we had a recent meeting where we went through and tried to list all of those, and that's going to be distilled into a number of reports. There's been a lot of investment in pandemic preparedness centres in a number of places. We are waiting to hear about an application that we've put in for a centre to do human experimental challenge work as part of the pandemic and future pandemic planning.
Thanks for that. I'm going to Ben. We've got two down here. I'm going to finish with Ola because I think after that we're pretty well out of time. So Ben, next.
So what is long-COVID?
What's long-COVID?
What is long-COVID?
What's long COVID?
Yeah, so it's sometimes called post-COVID syndrome. After people have had COVID, then they typically recover, but sometimes are left with problems. I mean, in the volunteers that we infected, quite a few of them lost their sense of smell and didn't get that sense of smell back for 6 to 8 weeks. Fortunately, all our volunteers have now regained their sense of smell. We didn't see any other prolonged symptoms, but there is a large number of people now who have not recovered fully, some of whom are my friends or my colleagues, who are no longer able to work because they are so exhausted, their muscles ache if they're trying to exercise. There's a whole spectrum of different symptoms, including something called brain fog. They just can't concentrate, they can't remember, and many of you may be familiar with brain fog, but that's one of the other particularly worrying long-term complications of having had COVID. So long COVID is a real worry in terms of our workforce and our health service.
Good question. Thanks for that.
What's your favourite part of your job?
I think meeting with young people and hearing their ideas, and mentoring people, guiding them in their careers, and trying to get them to give all their best to science. Favorite part of my day, I would say, is cycling to and from work. I love being on my bicycle. I was on my bicycle a lot when I was at Sydney.
Listen to those small questions. One of them is, do you think there's a chance of another pandemic starting up anytime soon? And the other question was, when you mentioned, I think it's vaccina, which is when you have the vaccine
and
it gets infected, when you mentioned eczema, would that be for very severe cases of eczema or just a few?
Okay, all right. I suppose the question is a
$6 million question. Yes, I think there is no doubt at all we will see more pandemics. How soon, we don't know. What virus, we don't know. But, there are other pandemics that we're very worried about. You know, viruses acquiring other properties from other viruses, allowing them to spread via the respiratory route. Imagine if HIV, instead of meaning close personal contact, mutated into being a respiratory virus, and then spread them widely. That is conceivable that you could get a virus with hybrid ability to cause pandemics emerging from somewhere. And the way in which the world is changing makes pandemics more likely than they've ever been in the past. So I think it's certain that we will see more pandemics and we need to be prepared. The question about vaccinia in people with eczema. So it only applies to people who are given vaccinia virus, that's the original rather virulent smallpox vaccine. It doesn't apply to people who are given the pox virus vaccine, which is intramuscular modified vaccine, ANCRA, which is very much attenuated pox virus. So it's really a historical thing. But I mean, there are risk factors for having more severe reactions to some vaccines. Yeah, so that is a really very deep question. On one hand, we are exposing them deliberately to human pathogens that will cause harm. So that risk is known to us, known to them, explained, calculated, put in proportion in relation to, say, the risk that you undergo harm by driving 200 miles to a store. So, I made a decision to put myself in harm's way in order to come here today. And, you can actually apportion risk. Professor Spiegelhalter in Cambridge was very good at putting risk in context. So we were able to calculate what sort of risk we were exposing our volunteers to, and they were able to accept that risk in relation to the risk of not doing the experiment, which itself could indirectly cause harm by default. The lack of information about COVID or flu or whatever else it is that we're using to inoculate, we don't do those experiments, harm will result. So they were presented with all the information and they signed up. The way in which you present the information is very strictly regulated by the ethics committees. But the ethics committees work with us to ensure that whatever we're doing is according to very strong guiding principles.